Welcome to another informative video brought to you by Autruo. The last time, we look at synchronous motors. The major difference between reluctance motors, permanent magnet synchronous motors, and separately excited synchronous motors were discussed in detail, coupled with some practical examples. In today's series, we will be looking at asynchronous motors. The way these machines are designed will be discussed in detail, coupled with some practical examples. Stay tuned. Asynchronous motor can also be known as an AC induction motor. Or in its short form, it is known as ASM or IM motor. Asynchronous motor is a motor that works on the principle of electromagnetic inductions. So basically, in order to produce a mechanical torque, there has to be some reaction between the stator and the rotor. So when the stator is energized, an electromagnetic field will be created which will later be induced in the rotor. This means, the rotating magnetic field of the stator will cut the stationary rotor. And as a result, the rotor will start rotating. And generation of the electromagnetic field coupled with its interaction was what birthed the name called induction motor.
Of course, when a set of coils is energized, an electromagnetic field will be generated which will react with the rotor. As a result, or let's say the outcome of these interactions is what is known as torque. The torque of the rotor will provide mechanical energy. And this energy is what we usually take advantage of in factories today.
A synchronous motor can further be subdivided into two, which are Squirrel cage motor and wound rotor motor. The wound rotor is also called slip rings motor. Squirrel cage motor is an induction motor in which the rotor consists of a series of bars arranged in the grooves of the rotor ring. This bar can either be made of aluminium or copper. The bars are joined at both ends by rings of the same materials. So basically, in order to reduce torque oscillations on the rotor at some speeds, the bar of the rotor is usually slightly twisted. The twisting of bars results in drastic reductions in the magnetic hum, which drastically reduce the mechanical noise afterward. And it also makes the motor to run more smoother as a result.
Perfect, Alex. Again, apart from the fact that twisting the bar tends to reduce torque oscillations on the rotor, it is primarily designed to prevent the cogging phenomenon, which is a phenomenon in which, if the rotor conductors are straight, there are chances of magnetic locking or strong coupling between the rotor and stator. In the same vein, it also prevents crawling, because crawling is a phenomenon where harmonic components introduce oscillations in torque. All these will in turn improve the starting torque and the starting power factor of the motor.
Nice pieces of design. So the plan is to reduce the gap between the rotor and the stator. And in the same vein, it prevents magnetic locking, which is because the bar is skewed. It will not align on a single pole. Instead, it aligns on multiple poles, and because different fields are generated as a result of the connected AC power supplied. Hence the reason.
On the other hand, The stator of the squirrel cage induction motor is the outermost component of the motor. The stator can be constructed for single-phase, three-phase, or even polyphase motors. So basically, only the windings on the stator varied. Not the basic layout of the stator. It is made up of a number of stampings. This stamping are slotted to receive the windings. Let's see the construction of a three-phase stator. The three-phase windings are placed on the slots of the laminated core, and these windings are electrically spaced 120 degrees apart. These windings are connected as either star or delta. These terminal connections depend on the requirement. Again, these windings connections will be discussed in the coming series. The insulation between the windings is generally varnish or oxide coated. The next one is the slip ring electric motor. Unlike the squirrel cage motor, the rotor ring grooves are inserted into the windings joined by a common point. The common point connections can also be known as star connections. The other end of the winding is connected to the slip rings. The slip, on the other hand, is designed in such a way that it will rotate with the shaft. During rotation, the brushes will make contact with the slip. These will allow the rotor windings to be connected to an external circuit. The external circuit is usually made of some set of variable resistors. With this set of resistors, the current in the rotor can be adjusted via the resistors, and as such, the generated torque can be controlled.
Perfect. Although the rotor with wounded winding tends to allow progressive starting through the externally connected circuit. However, nowadays, induction motors are usually operated via electronic devices. The reason for this is that with inverters, the efficiency and the torque of these motors can be increased and maintained. So this type of motor is not commonly found in industries as a result.
Again, just like the squirrel cage motor, the stator of this motor can be constructed for single phase, three phase, or even polyphase motors. However, these depend on the application of the motor. For domestic use, single phase motors are commonly used, while for industrial use, three phase motors are commonly used. Now that we have known how induction motors are constructed and the major difference between squirrel cage and slip ring motors, now let's look at how induction motors work. Of course, we know that this motor is also divided into two, which are based on the stator windings. These are single-phase and three-phase motors. For single-phase motors, we have capacitor start and capacitor run, and shaded pole induction motor. But we will be looking at three-phase motor windings. When the motor is connected to a three-phase AC main, current will flow from the main down to the motor winding via the motor terminals. The flown current will generate a rotating magnetic field in the stator windings. Now the rotating magnetic field will induce a voltage in the bars of the squirrel cage rotor, which can either be made of copper or aluminium. Now, because the conductor bars are short-circuited to each other at the lower and upper ends, the induced voltage will produce a flowing current in the bars.
Perfect, Alex. Because both ends are shorted, current will continue to flow as a result. So basically, it will move from one bar to another bar as a result of the shorted ends. Perfect.
Now, the short circuit current in the bars will generate a magnetic field in the rotor. The generated magnetic field tries to follow the magnetic field of the stator, and as such, mechanical torque will be generated which will rotate in the direction of the magnetic rotating field of the stator. So during rotation, the rotor will try to reach the speed of the stator, but it can never do. Instead, it will continue to chase the stator's magnetic field.
On the flip side, when the rotor rotates at the same speed as that of the stator, then no voltage will be induced in the bars of the rotor. Therefore, no current will flow in the bars which can be used to generate a torque. So basically, the rotor speed must be lower than the speed of the stator before the induction motor can generate a torque.
The difference between the stator and rotor speed is what is known as slip speed. Again, the asynchronous motor can be used as a motor or as a generator. In motor mode, the magnetic field of the stator always rotates faster than the rotor. However, reverse is the case for generators. In generator mode, the speed of the rotor is slightly higher than the stator magnetic field.
Now let's look at the speed to torque characteristic curve of induction motors operating at 50 or 60 Hz. Looking at this curve, squirrel cage with round bars is known to produce low torque at lower speed, while the reverse is the case for a rotor with rectangular bars. Rotor with rectangular is known to produce torque that is higher than round bars rotor at a lower speed. Again, this is due to the increase in resistance that this rotor has. Slip ring motor, on the other hand, produce high starting torque when compared with squirrel cage motors. Because the resistance of this rotor can be varied externally via the external connected resistors. The common efficient way to control the asynchronous motor speed of many loads is with VFDs. By using an inverter, the frequency of the connected voltage can be adjusted. Because only the frequency is adjusted, this allows a constant torque to be achieved over a long speed range. Now let's look at the major difference between a synchronous motor and an asynchronous motor. For a synchronous motor, this is an AC motor that runs at a synchronous speed. Which means, the speed of the rotor is the same as the speed of the rotor. This is why the motor is known as a synchronous motor. On the other hand, a synchronous motor runs at a speed that is lesser than the synchronous speed. The rotor speed and stator speed are different. Now for the principle of operation. The operating principle of the synchronous motor is based on the principle of magnetic interlocking between the magnetic fields of the stator and rotor. The asynchronous motor works on the principle of electromagnetic induction between the stator magnetic field and rotor circuit. For expression of speed, synchronous speed is 120 multiplied by F and P, where F is the supply frequency and P is the number of stator poles. So basically, we can get the rated speed of the motor from this mathematical calculation. Where for asynchronous motor the stator speed is greater than the rotor. For speed dependency, the speed of the synchronous motor depends upon the frequency of the input AC supply and the number of poles on the stator. The speed of an asynchronous motor, on the other hand, depends upon the mechanical load, rotor circuit resistance, and slip in the motor. In actual practice, the speed of the asynchronous motor is always less than the synchronous speed. Now, as for the slip. In a synchronous motor, there is no slip. Both stator and rotor rotate at the same speed. However, there is a slip in an asynchronous motor, and it is always greater than 0 and less than 1. Also, the effect of load on speed. The speed of the synchronous motor does not vary with the variation in the load. For asynchronous motor, the speed of an asynchronous varies with the change in the load. For rotor supply, The rotor of the synchronous motor requires an extra input supply to produce the rotor magnetic field. In the case of asynchronous motor, if the rotor is squirrel cage type, then there is no need of rotor supply. But the wound type rotor needs extra supply input. For speed control, the speed of the synchronous motor is controlled by changing the supply frequency using VFDs. The speed of an asynchronous motor can be controlled either by using variable rotor resistance or VFD. For power factor corrections, synchronous motor can be operated at lagging, leading or unity power factor. So by varying the power factor excitation, it can be used to correct lagging or leading power factor. The asynchronous motors, on the other hand, always operate at a lagging power factor. Now let's look at its applications. Synchronous motors can be used for driving mechanical loads as well as power factor correction. Asynchronous motors can only be used for driving mechanical loads. Induction motors are one of the most widely used motors in industries. This is because the motor is a bit cheaper when compared with synchronous motor, hence the reason why it is widely used. In the next series, we will be looking at DC motors in general. The way these motors are designed will be discussed in detail, coupled with some practical example. Hope you have learned something new today. See you at the next one.